Welcome to Oakland Connection. I'm your host, Tim Burns. I'm pleased to be joined by Oakland County Treasurer Andy Meisner. Thanks for being on the show, Andy.
Hey, my pleasure. Thank you, Tim.
So for our viewers out there who might not be that familiar with what the county treasurer does, can you tell me a little bit about your responsibilities?
Certainly. The county treasurer essentially serves as the banker for Oakland County. All the money that comes into the county from different sources, taxes, state, federal government, comes in through my office.
Okay.
And, a lot of the things like paychecks and payments to vendors that leave my office, go through it.
Right.
The extra money or surplus I invest on a short-term basis. And right now I've got about $1 billion county taxpayer dollars that we're investing in, largely in local community banks and credit unions and institutions. And then I also handle the delinquent tax administration process.
Okay.
And serve as the treasurer for a number of county organizations, like the County Retirement Board.
All right.
The Economic Development and Business Finance Corporation.
All right.
The Detroit Zoo Authority, the Oakland County arm of it. And so it's a pretty varied job.
So now, recently, the millage for the zoo through Oakland County just was recently adapted, wasn't it?
Yes.
So that's a relatively new responsibility for you doing that.
Yes, and I handle, it's actually the Oakland County Zoo Authority is technically the name of it, but my office serves as treasurer for that authority, and we assist in the collection of those millage revenues and forward those on to the to the Zoological Society to support what really is a fantastic institution that really is an economic boost for the region and certainly for Oakland County. And I think that they've had a record summer this year. I don't know if viewers have been over there, but zoo is looking really good.
Great. Down there in Royal Oak, it really is a jewel of Oakland County, and glad we were able to work that out so that it's able to keep operating and stay in business for everybody there.
I'm a big fan of the polar bears. If anyone hasn't seen the polar bear exhibit, you're sitting there with a 1,200-pound polar bear in this tunnel right above you, and so it's a lot of fun.
And that's a good place to go on a hot day, too, like we've had this summer.
Plenty of those this summer, that's right.
So, on a little more serious note here, you mentioned dealing with delinquent taxes.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about some of the work you're doing with United Way to help people with foreclosures and dealing with those types of issues?
Sure. As you mentioned, Tim, I do deal with tax foreclosures, and that is a very serious matter. The tax law in Michigan on property taxes is, pretty harsh. And if somebody falls behind in their taxes, it's requires them to pay some pretty nasty interest and fees. And unfortunately, I have to administer that. We're seeing an increase in the number of tax foreclosures.
Right.
Now, the foreclosure that more people are aware of is the mortgage foreclosure.
Right.
And, Oakland County has had, more than its fair share of mortgage foreclosures, over the last several years.
Right.
And that's something that has caused our property values to decline. In 2007, 2008, before the burst, we had $64 billion in taxable value. Right now, it's about $50 billion. And it's just, torn up neighborhoods throughout Oakland County. And so part of the response that I've tried to initiate as county treasurer is an innovative strategy called www.fightmortgageforeclosure.com/Oakland.
Okay.
And it's an online portal that's sponsored by the United Way, part of a regional collaborative with Macomb, Wayne, and Washtenaw counties. And anyone in Oakland County who is experiencing any difficulty relating to foreclosure, and that could include wondering whether or not you might apply for one of the federal programs, the loan modification program, or the new hardest hit program that provides actual cash subsidies up to $750 a month for families that are in real tough shape.
Okay.
We have certified housing counselors that will work with you and kind of guide you through the process. And if there's a difficult case, since I'm investing so much money with the banks, I'll get on the phone and say that Oakland County has got a strategic interest in preventing this foreclosure. And, no matter how the foreclosure happened, you know, maybe somebody made an irresponsible decision, tried to stretch a little bit too far for the American dream, or maybe they were victimized of predatory lending. Mm-hmm. Either way, Oakland County suffers the impacts in drops in property values from that loss.
Right.
And so we try to deal with it as much as we can on the front end. And strongly encourage anybody you know that might be watching the show to think about themselves, their friends, and their loved ones, and to be sure to contact us at fightmortgageforeclosure.com/Oakland,
okay.
or call my office at 858-0627, and let's get you connected with a housing counselor. You know, Tim, you've been a real advocate for consumer affairs for a number of years, and I'm sure that everyone is familiar with your reputation. One of the things I'm real concerned about is that there are folks out there that are marketing foreclosure prevention services.
Right.
And they might be attorneys, they might be people just kind of pretending to offer this service or claiming to,
right.
charging thousands of dollars. I just had somebody in the office today who got ripped off by one of those scam artists.
Right.
And so that's why it's so important for us to steer these folks to certified housing counselors that can actually help them stop digging. And, you know, if you can't pay for your mortgage, you probably can't afford foreclosure prevention services either.
Right. And unfortunately, you know, from my experience with a decade at the Better Business Bureau,
sure.
that, you know, it's like the scam artists really look for when you're at your most vulnerable. And then they always know that people will be able to scrape up some money to be able to try to do that last-ditch effort. And that's where they make a lot of money and unfortunately use money that you already don't have to spend and to lose. So people really need to be careful about that sort of stuff. And you know, contact a reliable person like County Treasurer Andy Meisner and get some information before you might go to one of these businesses that are charging you. One thing you need to recognize with those types of businesses is that it's illegal for them to charge you an upfront fee. So before you give someone that money, understand that.
That's a great point. I just had a guy in my office today who paid $3,000. The person ended up using an alias and a made-up association with a law firm and just took off with the money. And it's a travesty. But appreciate your leadership on that issue allow me to help get the word out about that.
Well, I appreciate that. You're always one of our favorite guests on the show.
Thank you.
And always have a lot of good information for the viewers. So, you know, I know we were talking before we were on the air here that you had just came from working and finalizing one of the county's auctions. Can you tell us a little bit about what that involved?
Sure. You know, as I mentioned, you know, it's a very serious matter. But there are cases where somebody gets delinquent taxes. And despite our many efforts to reach out and to get them on a payment plan, even if it's $25 or $50 a month, you know, we have some people that just, you know, that won't do that. They won't show the good faith to say, this is my debt and I'm going to work it off. Or they might just walk away from the property. We've seen growing numbers of banks that take a property in mortgage foreclosure and then allow it to go to tax foreclosure because they don't want to pay the taxes.
Right.
So we had about nearly 1,200 properties that we auctioned off, you know, today and yesterday, the day of the taping, which today I guess is Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
Had that difficult task of, you know, not being able to get the back taxes from the taxpayer.
Mm-hmm.
The state law then requires me to offer those properties at auction. And so what I did for the first time was entered into a partnership with the North Oakland County Board of Realtors and some of the area realtors to try to harness their private sector expertise in tapping into families that can buy those homes, get them back on the tax rolls, and then contribute to the stability of that neighborhood. You know, maybe sending their kids to the local schools, participating in civic affairs, but helping to kind of undo some of the damage that has been done to the community, whether it be hundreds of homes, commercial properties, industrial properties, or a fair number of subdivisions that were started before the bubble burst, and that now, you know, are not just viable, and so they were lost to taxes.
Right. Now, I know I've heard that you've grabbed a lawnmower and gone out and mowed the lawns of some of these houses that the county has taken custody of. So what's the situation with that? Is that before the auction, or is somebody's not get bid on? Tell us a little bit about that.
I will get my John Deere out and go out and mow some of those lawns and change some of the locks. You know, particularly last year, as I was kind of in my first year really running the auction. And what that is, that's about when the county takes the property as of March 31st of the third year that the taxes are delinquent. Okay. At that point, the property becomes the responsibility of the county. Right. And so we need to get out there and mow the lawn, try to secure the property, and do what we can to prepare it for sale.
Right.
This year, you know, based on some experience last year, you know, we made some investments in maintaining the properties and finding some of the nicer homes and mm-hmm. cleaning those up
right.
and then turning them over to realtors, you know, to tap in and kind of show the properties and to market them.
Right.
And I got to tell you that the response was unbelievable. Last year, we had 300 people come to the auction.
Okay.
This year, we had over 800 people that came.
Great.
And we did over $5.5 million in sales. Now, every one of those $5.5 million mm-hmm. are dollars that we're not going to have to now turn to the taxpayer and put on the taxpayer's tab.
Right.
Instead, we were able to get those properties, you know, into the private sector and to make them productive. So they go from being a problem to part of the solution. And I'm really proud of the staff at the Oakland County Treasurer's Office and some of our vendor partners
right.
Who helped make it such a huge success. And if I may say, there's a woman named Cassie Patterson,
okay.
No relation to Brooks,
okay.
Who's worked in the office for 37 years and is retiring this year. So this was her last sale.
All right.
But in particular, I want to thank Cassie Patterson for her dedication. And right. if you can imagine, 37 years of service to Oakland County.
That's going to be a lot of experience to have to replace there.
we're already on the job, and she's promised to be available for us to help out if we need her.
And these auctions take place up at the Board of Commissioners Auditorium?
Yeah, that's exactly right. We had the Board of Commissioners Auditorium packed to the gills, standing room only, and it was pretty full in there.
Right. You know, I've noticed recently that you've been on the national news. Can you tell us a little bit about what that's about?
You know, the mortgage foreclosure prevention strategy is just one part of the continuum. You know, that's about preventing.
Right.
But after the damage has been done, you know, we've lost real value, $14 billion. And I am really committed to making sure that the institutions that are responsible for us losing that money are paying their fair share. And so I initiated a first-in-the-country lawsuit against Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac for them claiming a government entity exemption to the real estate transfer tax.
Okay.
When you or I sell our home in Michigan, mm-hmm. we have to pay a real estate transfer tax.
Right.
Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac have been claiming that they're government entities and they don't have to pay it, even though they have CEOs who are making over $5 million,
okay.
they have a board of directors, and they're traded on the New York Stock Exchange.
Hmm.
And so I filed a, you know,
yeah.
And by the way, their website mm-hmm. says, we are not a government entity.
Right.
And so I think it's really disingenuous that they're claiming this. And so I filed a lawsuit
okay.
On behalf of the Oakland County taxpayers mm-hmm. To recover between $2 and $4 million in lost real estate transfer tax revenues to
okay.
Oakland County, and between $10 and $20 million for the state of Michigan.
Okay.
And we've got some national coverage on it, and I've got public officials as far away as San Francisco who are initiating lawsuits based on my lawsuit.
Okay.
And so it's kind of a nice opportunity for Oakland County to demonstrate some right. national leadership
exactly.
and to be really fighting to protect the Oakland County taxpayer.
Right. Well, our time's up for today. I appreciate you being on the show. Just one last segment here is, can you tell us how they can reach you if someone has a question for the Treasurer's Office?
Certainly. You know, I'm always available. And my office is 248-858-0624. That's 248-858-0624. They can visit me online at www.oakgov.com/treasurer.
Okay.
And then, as always, my cell phone is and always has been 421-ANDY. If people are in a pinch and need to connect with me personally.
I have to tell you, I am impressed. I was up at court the other day. I had to stop by and file something, so I was walking through the corridor where your office was, and I saw some cards with Andy Meiser on it for the public just to pick up, and there was your cell phone number on it, and I was like, wow, that's a stand-up guy. So
accessibility is important, and I know that's something that you've always subscribed to as well.
So I appreciate your service to the community. Thanks for being on Oakland Connection, and we'll have you back on again sometime soon.
Okay. Thank you so much, Tim. Appreciate it.
You're watching Oakland Connection, and I'm Tim Burns. I'm pleased to be joined by Circuit Court Judge Michael Warren. Thanks for being on the show, Judge.
My pleasure.
So, Judge, tell us a little bit about what your responsibilities are as a Circuit Court Judge.
Okay, I am the presiding judge of the Civil Criminal Division of the Oakland County Circuit Court. The Circuit Court is the county-wide court. We handle felonies and civil cases that involve $25,000 or more, okay, as well as family cases. And I'm kind of like the Secretary of State for the Civil Criminal Division. Okay. I'm in charge of that kind of department administratively.
Right.
And I have a criminal docket, which involves felonies, something as mundane as a credit card fraud transactions to as serious as a armed robbery, rape, or murder.
And so is the criminal docket a big part of your day-to-day job there?
It is. Most of the trial work is in the criminal side, and every week we go through 40 to 50 cases on a Thursday afternoon in my court, and so it certainly is very involving.
Okay. Now, and for I'm not sure if most of the people viewing realize this, but it's actually an elected position, isn't it?
That's right. The viewers may not know it, but they voted for Judge Michael Warren a couple of elections ago.
Oh, okay.
Now, some people are appointed and then serve and then are elected to retain the seat, and that's what happened with me.
Right.
I was Governor John Engler's last appointment to the bench, okay, praise God. And then I ran to keep the seat, and I was, okay, unopposed, praise God.
Right.
And ran again to keep the seat.
Okay.
And I'm up for election next cycle in 2012.
Okay. And you hold court up in Pontiac, right?
That's right.
Okay.
The 1200 North Telegraph Building.
All right. Tell me a little bit about, I know you and your daughter have been really involved with Patriots Week. Can you give us a little background about how you got involved with that?
Absolutely. Patriot Week was co-created by my daughter and I back in 2009. My daughter, Leah, who at the time was 10.
Okay.
And she is very gregarious and very intelligent, loves American history. And we've been talking about how our civic calendar, mm-hmm, has really been commercialized and stripped of its true meaning. It happens that I'm an adult convert to Catholicism.
Okay.
And that's given me a great insight on the importance of the liturgical calendar. We have all these holidays that we set aside to bring us back to our faith. Mm-hmm. And all the great religions have that. And America used to have a civic calendar. Washington's birthday, Lincoln's birthday, Memorial Day, Independence Day, Thanksgiving, Armistice Day.
Right.
And all those days have really lost their true meaning.
Right.
And so I was explaining this to Leah, and she got very upset, started pounding the table, and said we need to do something to renew the spirit of America and create a new celebration for America. So who was I to argue with? My daughter. So we sat down, we looked at the camera, said, fine, we're going to do it. And we noticed that September 11th, mm-hmm, through September 17th is a seven-day period.
Right.
September 11th, obviously, is the anniversary of the terrorist attacks.
Mm-hmm.
September 17th is the anniversary of the signing of the Constitution.
Right.
And we have those anchor dates, and we fill them in. Each day, we celebrate a founding first principle from a Declaration of Independence, like unalienable rights, limited government, the social compact, mm-hmm, equality, racial and gender, limited government.
Okay.
Key founding fathers and other great patriots they made that come alive, like Washington, Lincoln, Martin Luther King Jr., Susan B. Anthony.
Okay.
Key documents and speeches which embody that, like the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the I Have a Dream speech, and then flags that embody those from our history.
Okay.
A couple years ago, it was recognized by the State Senate in a resolution. Last year, it was recognized by the State Senate and the State House, bipartisan, unanimously adopted. And this year, we have a State Senate bill that was passed and a State House bill that has been passed. And now we're just waiting for one of the chambers to adopt the other chamber's bill, and then it would become law.
Right.
And we've had a lot of participants. We've had schools and Rotary clubs and Kiwanis's and senior centers, chambers of commerce, all across Michigan, but also across the country. We've had it,
okay,
in 12 states.
Great.
So far.
And that just started off from a conversation over the dinner table.
That's right. Over a lunch.
Over lunch.
You know, my daughter had a great idea, and we ran with it. So we have a brochure here if anybody is, okay, interested.
And you have a website?
And we have a website, and it's www.patriotweek.org.
Okay.
And at patriotweek.org, you can view standards, educational standards that we tie the content to,
mm-hmm,
different public events that are happening,
okay,
the schedule, et cetera. There's, okay, a lot of information there.
So this year, Do the dates are always the same, September 11th through the 17th?
Right.
And so for this year, do you have any special events planned locally?
We do. We have some fantastic events planned. On September 11th, this is the 10th anniversary, and we are having a Patriot Palooza on the 11th at historic Fort Wayne, not the city in Indiana, mm-hmm. but the fort, which was a hidden gem in Detroit. A lot of people don't know it's there.
Right.
It's a pre-Civil War era fort. It's on the riverfront. It's a gorgeous facility,
right.
And we're going to have reenactors, dignitaries speaking,
okay.
Patriotic music. The reenactors will be from the Civil War, Spanish-American War, World War I, World War II, Vietnam.
Sounds like a really, really great presentation there.
It's going to be a lot of fun.
Now, is there a fee involved with attending?
No fee. There's a $5 parking charge for secure parking, but other than that, it's free. And there's going to be a Civil Rights March, a reenactment of I Have a Dream speech by Bishop Edgar Vann from Detroit.
Okay.
Martin Luther King Jr. gave the I Have a Dream speech in Detroit first, which a lot of people don't know about.
Right.
So he's reenacting that speech.
Okay. And that information's all on patriotweek.org?
Yes.
Okay.
We have a public events button on our menu, and there's a lot of other events during the week.
Okay.
I know we don't have time for them all, but
right.
that's a key one.
Okay.
Holly, they're having a festival, a Patriot Week festival, which is on the 16th and 17th. That's going to be another great activity.
Right. All right, good. And what are your goals or expectations for expanding this even further?
Well, we definitely want to have the state pass those bills, and then the goal would be to go to other states, have them enact it so that they're permanently recognized, and then on to Congress. So
right.
the plan is to go to make it a nationally recognized holiday to renew the spirit of America.
Well, that sounds great. I really applaud the work that you're doing with you and your daughter and pushing this forward, and I hope you have great success in keeping it going.
Thank you very much. We very much appreciate it.
Now, talking a little bit on those founding principles, in addition to working on the Patriots Week information and being a judge, I see, and you brought a copy with you, that you're also an author, and you have a book here, America's Survival Guide.
Right.
You want to tell us a little bit about the book?
This was written at 10 o'clock at night for about 10 years,
okay.
and it does embody a lot of the themes that we talked about. I happen to be a former member of the State Board of Education, as well as still involved very much in education policy, and it's evidently clear that we have done an abysmal job on teaching our younger people for a couple of generations now what it means to be an American. And that's really why Patriot Week exists. Because we are founded on what we believe. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men. That's what makes Americans Americans. And we're really starting to lose what that means. So the book is about how we have started to lose that. It then goes through what our founding first principles are, the American Revolution, the Constitutional Convention, the Civil War, Civil Rights struggles, and then it's not a recommendations about what to do about the crisis.
Okay.
It's also can be found online at www.americassurvivalguide.com.
Okay.
And it's at Amazon and BarnesandNoble.com and all the other online retailers.
Right.
And it's really received an enthusiastic response. I'm very pleased with it. There's a real need and hunger out there. I think people are really starting to understand the crisis that we're in and that we need to ground ourselves, what makes us great. And as a free people, we're responsible for our freedom and liberty. And this helps equip people to look at public policy that way.
When I was flipping through some of the information on the book, something really stood out for me on the research that you did. And you talk about the nation's report card and that only slightly more than a quarter of high school seniors are considered proficient in civics.
Right.
And I think about, you know, we have all of these issues politically right now. And I hear a lot of people in the community complaining about politicians, but yet you somewhat think back to, well, we have to take some responsibility that we're the people who elect these people into office, too. So what are some of the recommendations you have? Because I think you're right on target with this, that, you know, if people just aren't tuned into what civics are and their responsibilities in a democracy, how are we going to have a successful democracy? Do you have some suggestions on how we can improve that?
Absolutely. The last chapter of the book is all about suggestions. Actually, one of them is Patriot Week, to renew our civic calendar to help inform and educate people. We also really need to transform our pre-K through really law school educational system. Mm-hmm. We have set it up in a way that's guaranteed to fail, where we have put history and civics on the back burner. There's a big focus on literacy, and we need that, and on math, and I understand that. Mm-hmm. But we've really done a disservice in connection with civics and history, so we need to emphasize that. Have it so that it's not just often you have it once in elementary school, once in mm-hmm. middle school, once in high school. It really should be a thread that continues throughout all the grades, mm-hmm. Where you're circling back and reminding students of what they've learned, but in a deeper and richer way. We need to revamp our teacher education schools mm-hmm. so the teachers are better informed, because they tend to do very poorly. Mm-hmm. What's scary about some of the statistics is that, and this came out after the book, is that our politicians know less history and civics than the general public. So if you think the public's in trouble, the politicians right. are even worse. And what's scary is, you know, think about the big issues mm-hmm. of the day. How many times have you heard people, the politicians in our lives, refer to the founding first principles, the rule of law, unalienable rights, equality? It's very, very rare. Right. And I think that really deprives us of the ability to really engage in these big policy issues. Mm-hmm. If you don't know your history, you're doomed to repeat it, is the right. old saying. And I think we're experiencing that.
No, exactly on point right there. And, you know, it's especially important to think out what's going on and have your own ideas and to be able to communicate and debate in a civil dialogue based upon facts and interpretations, and not just try to. I think we see too many people nowadays looking more at, it's like they take sides like a high school football game, and they're the winners or the losers. When we're like that, we all lose. We need to, you know, you don't have to always agree with everyone, but play a fair game and try to do what's best for the country, not be in a position where, you know, you're more concerned about beating your opponent than having the country win. So,
I couldn't agree with you more. And I think that the partisan atmosphere that we have today is so hypercritical that good, potentially good candidates just refuse to run. Mm-hmm. And the polarization, the politics has really become personal. And it's very difficult, I think, to be able to think through the issues when the opposite party is an enemy.
Right.
And I think that's become very corrosive and pervasive in our political dialogue. And when you, a lot of the issues of the day, for example, the debt crisis, there was a lot of discussion by the founding fathers about, is a debt good? If it is good, how do you manage it? Mm-hmm. Thomas Jefferson was very much anti-debt.
Yeah.
Alexander Hamilton was very much pro-debt. Yeah. And there was very informed discussions. Right. We don't get anywhere near that level of discussion in today's politics.
Right. So, well, I appreciate your coming on the show and giving us some really useful information, and we'll definitely be checking out Patriot Week this year, and I'm really interested in that Fort Wayne event. It sounds really interesting. And
very good. We
encourage our viewers
it.
To head down there.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
You've been watching Oakland Connection. I'm Tim Burns, and we'll see you next time.